The outreach is gigantic. Our next outreach is October 22nd, and we need all the help we can get to do that. We will have 200 to 300 children come through Harvest Fest. That's what we usually get. And we are able to share the gospel directly with every single one of them. We don't just stand up and preach it. They can't get to the fun stuff until they go through the steps of the gospel, and we give them candy on each step. So not only do they hear it, but their parents hear it. This is a true outreach on October 22nd, and we need all of your help. Please sign up for it and say, yes, I will be there. I will help with a trunk or treat. I will help with watching the kids bounce themselves into oblivion, because we will have three of them. And how many of you know that when you have three bouncers, you're going to have clonked heads? So we do need to have some people in there to deal with the mayhem. And so what I'm going to do this morning, however, is I'm going to start today with a little story. Is that unusual or, you know? Behold the lowly turtle who only makes progress when he sticks his neck out. Are we going to be able to do PowerPoint slides? It's completely died? That's depressing. I can act like a turtle. All right, think of a turtle. And notice how a turtle doesn't make any progress until it sticks its neck out. Okay? That's what we've discovered. Did you get it up? Oh, all right. Doug does such a great job of making all of these PowerPoints. He finds some good stuff. All right, so you've got a turtle, and the only way a turtle makes its way in the world is by sticking its neck out. And it's an illustration to us. It reminds me, there was this a lieutenant commander in the U.S. Navy back in 1944, and he ended up getting stuck. His name was James. He got stuck on this Espiritu Santo. It's a very remote island in the South Pacific. It was a long ways from where the Japanese were, and there was nothing really going on. He was an older man. He was in his 50s, and he was basically had nothing to do. So he's sitting around not knowing, you know, he's just trying to kill time, so he decides he wants to write something. Now, as he's writing, you know, he's talking to some friends of his, and he knows there's absolutely no chance that a completely unknown person like him is going to write anything that anybody's going to want to publish. And his friends confirmed for him what a loser he was and that he was never going to get this published. But he said, well, I got nothing better to do. And he said, well, but you know what? You never make any progress until you try, until you really stick your neck out, until you really push forward. So what he did is he started writing these short story collections. And of course, everybody told him nobody publishes short story collections. They just don't do that. But he thought, if you're going to make a change, you got to be a doer. You got to go try. So he did. He at the end of the war, he went and got the book published in 1947. And there were a few reviews. It didn't sell terribly well, but there was one guy, his name was Orville Prescott from the New York Times. And he managed to get a hold of it because of a Navy buddy who handed it to him. And when he read it, he went, you know, this is really, really charming. I like these stories. So he printed something about it in the New York Times saying that this was really cool. And of course, when you print it back then anyway, the New York Times was awesome. Today, another story. But anyway, the thing is, it took off and it went so well, it ended up winning a Pulitzer Prize. And so, again, his publisher was thrilled with it, but they said, you know, it's never going to really do much. It's never going to really go anywhere. So I think we're just going to, you know, run a couple more copies of the publishing run. And you know, that's it. But there was a guy named Kenneth McKenna who his job was to look for books that could be turned into movies. That was his job. And he loved this book. Pulitzer Prize, you know, bestseller. He thought this could be a great book. Every single studio executive said, no way. Because the lead would have to be in his 50s. And nobody wants that. We all want young actors, at least back in 1949. And we don't, you know, it's never going to fly. I mean, they just told him it wouldn't work. But McKenna believed in it so much that he personally bought the rights to this book and said, I'm going to do something with it. So he went to a couple of friends of his, which you may have heard of. Their names are Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein. And he said, do you think you could do something with this? Well, they said, well, we can make a great musical out of this and put it on Broadway. But all of the Broadway producers shut it down. They said, this will never fly. It will never fly. It'll never, because you, again, you have too old a lead and the stories are kind of mixed match. It's never going to happen. But how many of you know that South Pacific did a whole lot better than most people thought it would? We still talk about South Pacific to this day. When I was a high school music teacher, if you're going to do something in with your choir, you're going to pick a South Pacific song somewhere. Okay. And, you know, so not only did it become a huge hit on Broadway, but later it became a movie, 1950-something, and then it was remade later in the 80s. And it has been a huge hit ever since. And this, by the way, was the first of the books by a guy named James Michener. How many of you know that he's written a few other things since then? Okay, before he left, before he died. But the truth of the matter is, James Michener, Lieutenant Commander James Michener, in 1944, when nobody had ever heard of him on an island that no one had ever heard of, stuck there writing short stories about himself, nobody thought he could ever amount to anything. Nobody thought he would ever go anywhere. And if he had listened to that, we wouldn't have all of his stories today. We wouldn't have the books he's written. We wouldn't have South Pacific. Because the truth of the matter is that progress and change in your life only comes about when you are willing to stick your neck out. When you're willing to take the risk to do whatever it takes to make the changes you gotta make. That's what we are learning here. We've been studying the Bible chapter by chapter and verse by verse, and we've gotten up to Mark chapter 4, and we started looking at verse 1, we started looking at the parable of the sower and the seed. And what we've learned is that God's teachings about how to live, God's leading in your personal walk, as you begin to seek God, you're going to begin to get a leading from him. It's going to be planted in your heart that says, do this, change this, let go of this. And every single one of those things is going to require you to do something. Every single one of those things is going to require you to take a risk. You will never be able to make the changes that God wants to make in your life until you are willing to stick your neck out. It's extremely important that you grasp this concept, because so many people think that God is a gigantic genie in the sky. And if you just pray the right way, believe the right way, rub the lamp the right way, all the changes that you need to make will be miraculously dropped down into you like little gold coins dropping out of heaven. This is not how it works. God works by connecting with you. And as he connects with you, you are expected to do what he's leading you to do. And when you do that, then you grow. That's how it works. Connect, do, grow, which is the whole vision of this church. It's teaching this concept that it's about, you know, you've got to do your part of it. Now, the condition of the soil of your heart, the condition of your attitude to receive whatever it is that God is saying for you to do or to change, that condition of your heart, well, that's all up to you. It's all your choice. And it will never get better. It will never change until you're willing to take the risk to stick your neck out and do what you got to do to get it done. Now, so far, we found out that there's four types of hearts, four types of people who hear what God is saying. They hear it either through the word, through the Bible, or they hear it through their interaction with other Christians. They hear it just by the whisper of the Holy Spirit in their heart. But one way or another, they get a seed that says, this is what I got to do when it comes to my relationship with God. Now, the first type of person who receives that, the Bible says here in Mark chapter 4, that they have a hard heart. And that hard heart does not let God's word sink in. It just kind of sits loosely on them. And because of that, the devil comes along and just snatches it. So even what they had gets taken away from them. They never change. They never grow. And if you're the kind of person that looks in the mirror and recognizes the fact that the same problems, the same attitudes, the same drama are happening today that happened 10 years ago, you may have to consider that you have that hard heart. You may have to consider that and go, is that what's going on here? Now, to avoid that hard heart, we learned last week that you have to cultivate an attitude of wanting to act upon whatever God is speaking into your life. You have to want to act upon it. But now we're going to learn what happens even if you cultivate that attitude. Let us say you truly cultivate the attitude of wanting to respond to what God is leading. You decide, like you did last week, maybe you were listening, whatever, and you go, yes, I want to respond to whatever God is leading. Okay, that's great, but there are three possible results once you get to that point. So let's figure out what they are. Now, Mark chapter 4, verse 16 says this. He goes on with the next group of hearts, and he says, these likewise are the ones that are sown on stony ground, who, when they hear the word, they understand something coming in from God. What is it? I need three guys real quick. Large, go with him. Go. Three large men. Ooh, look at that. Five large men. This will go fast. It started raining. They need to get the bounce house down for the children's ministry. Everybody say, great for service. Awesome. All right, where was I? Okay, so they hear the word, they understand that God is leading them to do something, and they immediately receive it with gladness. So you're that person that says, I want to receive what God has for me. But they have no root in themselves. And so they only endure for a time. So you receive something from God, you get excited about it, but it kind of blows away really quickly because it only endures for a short period. It doesn't really go anywhere. It just kind of blows away. And afterward, when, not if, but when tribulation or persecution arises for the word's sake. In other words, when it becomes difficult to follow God, either your friends or your family or just the choices that you got to make, or maybe people wandering around in the streets that want to shoot Christians, which may happen someday. Either way, whatever it is, when persecution, when tribulation, when it gets difficult to keep following Jesus, these kind of people, they stumble, they fall, they give up, they quit, they're finished. Now, let's take a look at this. Remember, these people started out with the right attitude. I want to receive something from God. I have heard his speaking into me. He wants me to do X. I feel like he does. But are you going to go do it? How? It says receive. The word receive here in Greek is lambano, and it means to take as with the hand. So when he is saying they receive it, he's saying, look, these guys get it. They grasp it. There's no mistake. They totally understand what God wants them to do. But there's a problem. They're too shallow to let it really sink in. They're too shallow. Now, what does he mean by too shallow. Now, this is really important. He means that they are emotional hearers. Emotional. And he, notice how he uses the word immediately twice. He says they immediately receive it, and when tribulation comes, immediately they stumble. That sense of immediacy is explaining to us that these are emotional hearers, meaning that they don't consider, they don't understand, they don't contemplate, they don't sit down and take the time to really figure out the cost of receiving whatever it is that God wants them to do. They're not willing to go to that level. You see, there is a cost to responding to what God is leading you to do. But they are shallow, and here's why. Because they're busy chasing an experience. Does that make sense? A lot of people do this. They'll come to a church, and they will sense in their heart, I should plug in to this church. They get a word from God in their heart. This is the place. I need to plug in. I need to be involved. I need to stay right here and get connected. This is what God wants. And you feel it. But the problem is that because you're shallow, this is what he's saying. I'm not pointing my finger at you. I'm explaining this kind of heart, right? So, you know, I don't want you to take this personally. I want you to look at it and go, I don't want to be like this. Because if you're just chasing an experience, listen, some days you're going to come in here and the PowerPoint won't work and you can't sing the words and your experience just got lost. And you may say to yourself, well, I didn't feel it this Sunday, so I'll just bail out. And a lot of people do that. You know, I might preach a message which, you know, is a grand slam home run, and everybody feels it. And then for 2 weeks in a row, I may be really off the game, and it's the word, and it's being preached, but I'm just not feeling it. And when that happens, not if, because I am not God, and I'm not going to hit a home run on every Sunday. And the truth of the matter is that some people are shallow because they're seeking an experience instead of following what God says to do. Now, how many of you know that that's a really bad way to be married? You see, people who are married this way, I felt love, I felt romance, I felt excitement, but now I don't, so I'm out of here. People do it all the time. You can't build a relationship on emotion. You cannot build a relationship with the living God based on emotion. You cannot. It's the same kind of a thing. There's a reason that God says that Christians are the bride of Christ. He's trying to get it in your head. You can't base this on emotion. You have to base it on faith. I am God. I have given you a word. Some emotions are going to be good. Some are not going to be so good. You're going to go up. You're going to go down. But what you got to do is put your faith and trust in me. I said, do it, do it. That's what he's saying. Now, if you don't, you're shallow. That means that you are just an emotional hearer. Now, I said you've got to consider the cost. Let's take a look at that for a second. Luke 14, 28 and 33 says this. For which of you, this is Jesus speaking, you're intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake some things in your... Well, I'm sorry, it doesn't say some. Everybody say it with me. It says, whoever does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. That's a pretty heavy... That's a high bar to get to, isn't it? All. Jesus is saying, look, count the cost. You want to follow me? You want to have eternal life? You want to have a life that will be rewarded when you stand before me someday? Because how many of you know there's going to be lots of people that are going to be Christians and they're going to make it to heaven? And the Bible says that everybody's cup will be full, but somebody's going to have a thimble. I want a pool. And the only way to get there is you've got to decide, I'm willing to sacrifice it all. Now, if you hold back, this is what he's talking about here. You see, when he says they have no root in themselves, think about what roots do. Roots sink down deep in order to pull up the nutrients. And if they don't, they become shallow and exposed like this. And when they're shallow and exposed, how many of you know that the water, when it evaporates, if they're not down deep, the whole tree is going to die because it's not getting down deep and getting the nutrients and pulling them up. And that is the picture of somebody who soaks up the experience, but they won't go down and do the hard work of getting down deep into that real water, going deep with this stuff. Yes, they hear it and they go, I want to receive it, but it's just not a good time for me. Or this isn't very much fun. This isn't what I signed up for. Whatever the excuse is, they're not willing to get down deep and do the hard work that says, this is what God says that I need to do. What has to happen and change in my attitude in order to fix this, in order to change this? And you know what's interesting about this in Greek is this is a reflexive pronoun here. It means it's bouncing back on the person that's being spoken about. In other words, if your roots in life are your parents, your roots in life are this culture or your friends or how much money you have in the bank or how nice your car is or how classy you happen to be or whatever it is that's not Jesus Christ. If you are trying to find what you need in life based on your emotions or your experiences versus getting down deep and being real with God, then you have a shallow heart. And God is warning you that if you cultivate a shallow heart, his word will not have the effect on you that he wants or that you desire. Now, how do we avoid having a shallow heart? Well, when you don't take time to think things through, when you don't take time to stick things out, you become impulsive. You react emotionally. You become a drama king or queen. And when you get there, it's a stony life. Now, what am I talking about? You know what God is speaking about some area of your life, but you're unyielding to it. You won't even consider it because it's not a good time, or I just don't have time, or people just don't understand how difficult this is. And when you do that, it creates stony ground. Now, what do I mean? Stony ground, rocks, those are holdouts. You're not completely indifferent to what God wants to do in your life, but you're not willing to consider that. Okay, let me give you a couple of examples of what I'm talking about. There's a hypothetical person. They are living with their girlfriend, so they're having a sexual relationship with somebody that they are not married to. They come to a church like this. The word hits them, and they go, wait a minute. This is wrong. Fornication is wrong. The Bible says so, and just because I'm saying in my heart, well, I'm going to marry her someday, that's a lie, and you feel it. The word hits you, and you go, I should act on this. I should go to my girlfriend and say, we can't sleep together anymore until we get married. I got to move today. But you don't consider doing something that radical and weird. I mean, your friends and family, what would she think? What will her family and her friends think if you just move out? They'll think you're a religious wacko. And yes, you are. Because are you going to be wacko for Jesus? Or are you going to be wacko for whatever it is you want? You see? So the word hits you, but you won't even consider doing something that radical. And because of that, you have a stone in your life. You have a stone in your life, and it makes you shallow. And so you'll go to another church that doesn't make you feel like that. You see what I'm saying? Or how about being a teenager? You go to a camp or you go to some experience and you go to Future Quest with us in San Diego and you go, wow, I mean, and it's just, rah, Jesus. And you're so fired up. And the word comes to you that you're hanging out with these kinds of friends. You need to outgrow those kind of friends and start hanging out with these. But you won't even consider that because you got way too many people on your Instagram account. You can't do that. So instead of unfriending them, then they are the ones that are influencing you. Instead of acting on it, no, you got a stone in your life. That's an area that you won't give over to God. You'd rather go to another church. You'd rather not go back to Future Quest or whatever it happens to be because you just don't want to go there. Your eyes are opened. You finally get it. You got to do something. But you're not willing to go and put that filter on your internet because you say in your mind, well, I know ways around that filter. And because I already know ways around that filter, I'm just going to sin anyway, so why bother trying? That's a rock in your life. That's a rock. It creates stony ground. It creates stony ground. Now, when you feel pressured by how your friends or your family say you should live, and after this, you're going to cave in. You're going to quit. You're not even going to try. Look, it's true. If you put a filter on your internet, most of us are intelligent enough to figure out how to get around it. But if you put a filter on your internet, you are acting on what God is leading you to do. So yes, you may stumble again, but you are making the steps. You are doing what it takes. You are acting. That's a whole different animal than the one over here that says, ah, well, I'm going to screw up anyway, so why bother trying? See, why bother trying, stony heart? I'm going to try anyway, even though I know I'm going to fail, because guess what? How many of you know that the day you gave your heart to Jesus Christ, he already knew all the sins you were going to make? He already knew. He already knew all the times you were going to still betray him, even after he gave his life to pay for your sins. He already knew that. And he still applied the blood of Jesus to you, even when he knew you were going to continue. That's how much he loves you. He wants you to love him back the same way and go, I know I'm going to mess up, but I'm going to try. Hallelujah. I'm going to try. And then I'm going to try again. And when I fall on my face, I'm going to get up and I'm going to brush it off and I'm going to say, you know what? There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, Romans 8:1. I'm going to keep going because I'm not going to cultivate a stony heart. I will keep rooting out rocks and keep rooting out rocks and keep rooting out rocks and throwing them away until that soil is so good it produces a crop that'll blow everybody's mind. That's the attitude that you and I need to have if we're going to be Christians this morning. That's what we have to do. King David understood this in Psalm 51. He said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Guys, he prayed that way late in life. He didn't say, well, you know, I'm too old. I've already committed adultery. I've already killed Uriah the Hittite. It's already a waste of time. Everything's lost for me. I might as well quit. He didn't say that. He got on his face and he said, create in me a new heart. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. I'll try again. I'll try again and again and again because I put my trust in you and not in my own efforts. You see, this is the point. You need to be constantly submitting any holdout area in your life to Jesus Christ. Constantly. And when you fail, you do it again. And when you fail, you do it again. And when you fail, you submit it again. And when you fall off the wagon and you get drunk, you go back to another AA meeting and say, well, I'm on day one. But you start again. You don't quit. Because if you quit, stones. And when you have stones, you're not growing anything in Christ. You're not getting anywhere. Now, take a look at what happens next. Verse 16, he says, now these are the ones who are sown among thorns. They're the ones who, they hear the word too. And the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches and the desire for other things enter in and they choke out the word so that it becomes unfruitful. This is not a pretty picture. See, the truth is, you know, my cousin's was, not anymore, but he was a farmer. He was a wheat farmer in Saskatchewan. And he's been here many times. He's usually a snowbird. We're looking for him to blow in on the cold winds here soon. And he comes here every year as a wheat farmer. And what he discovered is that when he was planting wheat seeds like these, it took 60 pounds of wheat seeds in order to sow 1 acre of land. But he had a problem. There were already 3,000 pounds of wheat seeds in that soil before he ever dropped a wheat seed in it. It's preoccupied. It's already there. The seeds are already there. You see, a heart, listen, if your attitude, if your heart is already preoccupied, if it's already crowded with so many other things, then what God is leading you to prioritize is not your priority because you're distracted by so many other things. God wants you to prioritize connecting with him in real relationship from your heart to his, one of you at a time. And you're not prioritizing that. You're prioritizing other things. You're preoccupied. And when that happens, you just grow thorns. And it chokes out anything that God's word could do in your life. See, the word, God's word, God's direction, God's leading is still coming to you. It even grows a little bit, but there's no real fruit. It doesn't really produce because there's too much competition for resources from all the weeds. Now, you only have so much energy available in your life. You only have so much. God only provides you with one body and one mind, so there's only so many directions you can take. There's only so many drives, only so many ambitions, only so many things that you can focus on. And the result is if you don't prioritize things in your life, you're going to become the jack of all trades and the master of none. That's what's going to happen. You're going to have too many projects. Now, it says there are three things here that can choke this out. It says the deceitfulness or lies of riches, the cares of this world, the desire or the lust for things. So let's take a look at these three things because you need to root them out of your life. Now, the first one is cares. In Greek, that means anxiety or to be pulled in different directions. So this is a picture of a person who is so over busy with what the world says is important. I'm not saying that you shouldn't be busy. There are too many Christians that are not busy enough. But what are you busy about? Does that make sense? And when you're so busy with the things that the world says are valuable, the world says is important, then you become anxious and distracted. How do you root that out? I'm going to tell you how, and when I do, you won't like it. You won't. The solution is service. It's true. See, when you're so distracted with so many other things, do you realize, I mean, when Mike came up here a few minutes ago, I didn't ask him to come and speak about this pastor appreciation thing. I didn't even know it was in October. Thank you very much. I didn't know. You know what I mean? So he comes up and he speaks, but he made a comment about how if you get involved on our next outreach, it takes the stress down on us. He's absolutely right. Because do you have any idea how hard it is to get people to do anything? It's really, really, really hard because they are so distracted by so many other things. And why should I do something at the church that doesn't make me any money, that doesn't entertain me, that's sacrificial, that's hard, that's going to be, you know, stretching me? I don't want to do that. I've got more important things to do. I mean, the game is on. Right? You know, I've got Netflix to watch. You know? You see, when we're distracted, when we don't do it, the way to solve that problem is to get involved in service. When you say, I will be involved and I'll do it consistently. What it does is, listen, it forces you to budget your time. Let me say that again. When you say, I will be consistently involved in serving God through my church, when you choose to do that, you can't do that unless you budget your time. And the only way to budget your time is to sit down and go, what am I spending my time on? Let me prioritize it. See, God is amazing. He's so smart. He knows that if you are willing to get involved and get serving, it keeps weeds from growing in your garden because you've prioritized things. And suddenly, he becomes a priority to you. Does that make sense? So he says, the cares of this world. Though the next one, he says, deceitfulness, which means, in Greek, that which gives a false impression, whether by appearance, statement, or influence. It's where you, the deceitfulness of riches, it's where you buy the lie that if you have more, you'll be more secure. You'll be more content. You'll do more for God then. But I've got news for you. If you're not willing to do it for him now, you won't do it for him then. If you're not willing to be faithful in a little, you will not be faithful in much. And people lie to themselves and they believe, well, if I just make more, well, then I can start giving to the church. But it is not so. If you won't do it now, you won't do it then because you're not prioritizing things. And guess what? If you choose to be obedient to God, and God, the principle is that you need to be consistent. See, there's a lot of people that will give financially when they are emotionally charged, right? But God's going, no. I set a principle way back in the Old Testament. It's a principle that was renewed in the New Testament. It's a principle. It's not a law. It's not about legalism. It's not about, you know, curses and blessings and all that nonsense. Look, it's just a principle. Who are you prioritizing in your life? When you say in your heart, I'm going to take X amount, and the very first thing I'm going to do on my paycheck is I'm going to give X amount to God's work. Because I prioritize him above everything and everyone. I don't care if X amount is $5. But whatever it is that you choose it to be, it needs to be consistent. Paycheck in and paycheck out. And when you do that, it doesn't allow the deceitfulness and the lies of riches to choke out what God wants to do. Why? Because it's the same thing. In order to do that, you have to budget. You cannot be a consistent giver until you actually take the time to budget. And when you take the time to the budget, all of a sudden you're going to realize how much stupid debt you have in your life. I need to fix that. I should pay that off. Because if I pay it off, it's going to be a whole lot. And then all of a sudden you're going to watch your debt load go down and your ability to do more go up just because you were willing to prioritize God first in your life. I have heard story after story after story of lost count of people who go, you know, I finally, you know, decided that I'm going to go ahead and tithe. And when I did, all of a sudden, everything opened up for me. It's because you prioritize God. Look, it's not magic. You have to make up your mind that you're going to prioritize God regardless of what will happen. I made my decision to start tithing, to, you know, consistently giving a specific amount that I chose. And it wasn't 10%, guys. I started with 2%. It doesn't matter what the percentage is. It just has to be consistent. I'm going to do this. I did that when I was a single parent. I did that when I was a single parent and wasn't getting my child support payment either. I said, God, I'm going to do this. And I have news for you. From that day to this, I have never gone without. Never. From that day to this. Now, am I rich and do I drive? You see my truck. I call it the beast. So no, you're not going to be getting, you know, a Mercedes or a Rolls Royce from this. No, but when you prioritize God, I'm here to tell you, I don't have anxiousness about it. It's like, hey, I'll come in. Because it always does. Because God's going, you prioritize me, I take care of you. I got your back. See, that's how you defeat the deceitfulness of riches. Now, it says lust, you know, the lust for, you know, lust is an epithumia. It's where we get our word thermos from. It's hot. It's warm. And he's talking about a desire, a craving, or a longing, or a desire for what is forbidden. Lust. Now, when you allow your desires to rule you, then lust will burn through your heart. And the way to defeat this is when you are willing to get accountable with someone else. You cannot defeat lust alone. You'll try, especially if you're male. The men in this room are going to struggle more with lust than others will, at least in one sense, sexually speaking. But women struggle with lust in a completely different way. Usually it is not about sex or pornography. Usually for them, it's the lust for being wanted, desired, and loved. And they're willing to lie, cheat, and steal in order to get it. They will. They'll gossip and snip and do all those things in order to feel it. It's a lust, and it cannot be quenched. And I'm here to tell you that you can't defeat it just by, you know, willpower. No, you have to connect. You have to connect with God consistently, and you absolutely must connect with others. I have accountability partners here, friends. People that I trust. People I have made connections with that I can go and say, I'm having a rough day, man. And they'll pray with me and pray for me. Until you have that kind of connection, you are not going to see this defeated in your life. So three things, he said, can choke out the word. And he gives you three solutions right here. The cares of this world, he says, look, get involved, connected in service, and watch how you reprioritize things when you do it. Deceitfulness of riches, look, start giving consistently, week in and week out, and watch how everything will line up, and you'll get your priorities straight. You got a problem with lust, it's causing an issue, get connected in a small group, get connected into, you know, small group. How many of you know that's going to be a sacrifice? You're going to actually have to get in your car and drive somewhere on a Thursday night. That's going to be tough. But if you really want to defeat it, you're going to have to be humble enough to look some other man right in the eye and say, you know what? I am struggling so bad with what's on the internet, I can't walk 4 feet without thinking about it. I need help. All right, brother, let me get with you. Let's put some internet filters on there. Let's have you call me every day or text me every day. How you doing? Let's put X3 Watch on your computer. It's going to send me a list week in and week out of what you're looking at. And I can call you and we can talk about it and we can pray about it and we can watch those stones one at a time get thrown out. But look, it's never going to happen unless you're willing to connect. And when you connect, then you can do. And when you do, then you'll grow. But not until. Now look what happens. If you respond to this, if you choose to respond to this, you're going to grow like crazy. You can find this in Mark chapter 4. Let's flip over there. Mark chapter 4, verse 20 says this, but these are the ones that are sown on good ground. They're sown on good ground, and they hear the word, they accept it, and it bears fruit. Sometimes it's 30 times what was put in. Sometimes it was 60 times as much. Sometimes it's 100 times as much. But it's because they were willing to pull the rocks out of their life. It was because they were willing to uproot those weeds and do whatever it takes. And because of that, now my word gets in their life and they explode in growth. They grow like never before. It's not a gimmick that we came up with a vision for this church. Repeat it after me. Connect. Connect. Come on. Connect. Do. Grow. That's the vision of this church. You should be able to talk to anybody that comes up and says, you go to this weird, it's got a weird name, 14 something. Yeah, 14-6 church, what's it all about? It's about connecting, doing, and growing. Wanna come? You should know the vision of this church inside and out because it's not just a gimmick. It comes from his word. It comes from here. This is what it's telling us. It says, look, connect with me in a real way. Connect with others in accountability. Do what I tell you. Act on it. Pull out the weeds. Pull out the rocks. And you will grow like crazy. Well, what kind of a heart do you have? We'll close with this. Look, if you got a hard heart, then God is challenging you to get serious with him. It's where you choose to soften your heart and say in your mind, I will not be indifferent. Now, some of you this morning, you felt a pull in your heart and went, I really got to go do something about that internet filter. I've been finding a way around it. Some of you have felt a pull going, I really do need to be a consistent giver and I'm not. Some of you felt a pull that said, I really need to get involved with others and get connected because I'm alone and I'm not really growing and I'm not really, you know. Do you have a hard heart? Because if you have a hard heart, that's just going to get snatched away from you. And by tomorrow, you'll forget the message I just preached. It'll be gone. The devil does not want this to sink in. He does not want you to grow like never before. He doesn't want that. But you can choose to be different. How do you do that? Well, if you've got a hard heart, you got to pursue commitment. Commitment. I'm going to do. Now, if you've got that shallow heart we talked about, well, God is challenging you to get real with him, to confess any area of your life that you are holding out from him. Any area. He's challenging you to do that. So if you've got a shallow heart and you recognize that today, then what you need to pursue is obedience. You've got to go, I'm going to act on this. But if you've got a crowded heart, if that's what you felt today, God is challenging you to reprioritize your life. You got to tear out the weeds, and that means you've got to do the things that we talked about. You've got to pursue single-mindedness. You got to go, well, if the problem is the cares of this world, well, then I need to get involved in service. I need to get involved in connecting in a small group because, you know, I need to reprioritize what's going on in my life. If it's the deceitfulness of riches, you've got to make up your mind. I'm going to pick an amount. Listen, again, I'm going to say it again. I don't care if it's $20. Make a commitment. Now, the Old Testament says 10%. But when I started tithing, I started it too. But the point is, you begin and you say, I've picked a number. It's between me and God. I'm going to do this. And maybe God will bless you to the point, I know a man who gives 50% of his income because God has blessed him to the point where he's a millionaire now. When he started out, he was mowing lawns, knocking on doors, starting a landscaping company. But he made a commitment, I will give. He started out at a small percentage. And every time God blessed him, he upped it. And God kept going, well, you're faithful with a little, I'll give you a little more. Oh, you're faithful with this, I'll give you a little bit more. He said, after 20 years, I am now at the position where I'm giving 50% of my income. And we sat down and we made a goal. And this is a true story. In fact, we're considering having him come and speak to you. He said, my wife and I have given $1 million, and we did it all mowing lawns. But it started out with a small little percentage. He said, now I've got a goal of doing 10 because it's just so much fun. Because now I'm at 50%. I've got all my bills are paid for. My house is paid for. My cars are paid for. And so we're just making money. And all my kids are all grown up. I'm grandpa now, so why not give $10 million? Because I can. How many of you would like to be in that situation? I would. Believe me, I'd like some of you to be in that situation. We could use a stage. But anyway, just being real, okay, just being real. If you've got a fruitful heart, God wants more fruit out of you. I didn't go into this, but it's true. God says, if you're bearing fruit, I'm going to prune you so you'll bear even more. I'm going to prune it back. So if you've got a fruitful heart, God is challenging you to invest your life even more. You need to pursue that fruitful heart and go, all right, God, what do you want me to prune back? Because I'll prune it back because I want more. John 15:8 says this. It says, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciple. If you want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ today, he wants you to bear fruit. That's what glorifies the Father. And he's saying, look, this is what I want. This is my word for you. I want you to be growing like never before. In order to do that, you got to do what I'm telling you to do. And everything I'm telling you to do will be hard. Everything will be sticking your neck out. Everything will be everybody around you telling you, you're a loser, you can't do it, it will never get there. If James Michener listened to that, he would not have become the best-selling author he became. But in order to do, you must connect. You've got to connect with God in a real way from your heart to his, and you got to connect with other believers. Connect, do, grow. So how do you apply this morning? Let me call my worship team up and my ushers as well. How do you do it? Well, let's see. I'll give you some options. Option number one is that you can pray with that prayer team this morning, because when we're doing the worship here in a few minutes, the prayer team will be in the back. And you can go, you know what? I have heard pastors say, come out and pray 100 times, and I won't do it because somebody might see me get out of my chair. You know what that's called? Pride. And gonna kill you. I've made it as easy as possible. I put it in the back. If you went to a charismatic church, we'd make you come to the front and stand in front of everybody and put up a sign. Come on. I made it easy for you. I love my charismatic brothers, but you don't have to come up here. I put it in the back. So you can go and you can pray about whatever it is that grabbed your heart. Another thing you can do, we talked about pursuing a fruitful heart. I said that service is the way to keep your life from being misprioritized. So put on your slip, I'm challenging you, Harvest Fest. Take the day off. Take the time off. Say, I'll be there. I want to have a position where I'm turning people away because I got too many workers, instead of what always seems to happen. Me and Melissa and Doug and Carrie and Dennis and Ellie are just pounding the dirt trying to do 12 different things because we don't have enough people. Come on. This is an outreach. This is going to take and glorify your king by taking the gospel into the hearts of the most vulnerable people out there, kids. They'll receive it. This is eternal. This is important. This is outreach. This is the real deal, and we need your help. And finally, you could decide, you know what? I need to become a member of this church. Not just I show up, but I'm committed here. I'm going to connect here. So put on the bottom of your slip, member. Because we're going to have a membership class later this month. And when we do, you could go, you know, I'm going to lock myself in here. I'm going to make this my church home. And remember, if you're just chasing experiences, some Sundays it's going to be great. Other Sundays you're going to go, eh, it's going to happen. But if you make a commitment, it doesn't matter if it's an eh Sunday. Was this an eh Sunday for you guys? Or? This was a good Sunday. Thank you. One person